thank you for having me, John. Title of my talk today is Developing CVD Production Equipment for Commodity Markets. CVD stands for chemical vapor deposition. It's a technique, it's a process where gas is delivered to a substrate and a solid film is deposited on that substrate, typically at elevated temperature. A few words about Centrotherm. Who are we? We're a machine builder. We design and manufacture equipment, production equipment, high-end production equipment for thermal processing. The industries that we serve for the most part are semiconductor device manufacturing and crystalline silicon solar PV. Our headquarters is in Blaubeuren in southern Germany, wider area of Stuttgart. But of course, we have customers in the US, in Europe, and in Asia. So we, of course, service our systems worldwide. Our current headcount is around 750. But like the semiconductor industry, we're growing fast. And annual turnover is in the range of 150 to 200 million. Here's a quick overview of the main systems that we're delivering to the respective industries. On the left, you can see our horizontal furnace. They're used for silicon device manufacturing, mainly power devices and MEMS. Customers apply a wide variety of processes, some just a pure thermal treatment, others also do run CVD processes that deposit functional layers or sacrificial layers on their silicon substrates. In the center are the systems that we provide to the customers that produce silicon carbide-based devices, typically high-power switching devices or high-power LEDs. These are vertical furnaces or single-chamber furnaces. Silicon carbide is a lot more difficult to process. It typically requires much higher temperature, so these systems are inherently more complex and also more expensive. On the right side, you can see the systems that we deliver to the silicon PV industry. They're, like on the left side, horizontal furnaces. Temperature range is pretty much the same. What differs is the substrate format. Silicon device manufacturing typically uses round wafers, 200 or 300 millimeters. In PV, our customers are using square type wafers. And there's also one large difference between the horizontal furnaces on the left and on the right. Customers that are using silicon produce silicon devices typically run a few hundred wafers per day through these systems. When you look at the customers that produce silicon PV devices, they typically run a few hundred thousand wafers through these systems each day. So even though the platform is similar, if you look at the details, the systems are a lot different. And in the following slides, I'd like to give a little bit of background how the development of the on the right really took place in the course of two decades, more or less. If you look at the early 90s, solar PV was still a niche application, very small market for Centrotherm. Main application was off-grid. It was small, but we saw growth. On the right-hand side, you can see a picture of what we call a solar cell. It's the key device that converts sunlight into power. And on these devices, typically, customers were depositing what we call anti-reflection coating. It's a coating that enables the cell to absorb more light, thus convert more light into power. And that film was deposited with what's called PECVD, plasma-enhanced CVD. And that's a process that we knew very well from the semiconductor industry. We even had a platform. We only had to adapt it to the needs of the PV industry, of the photovoltaics industry. Now you have to bear in mind that a solar cell would cost maybe a few dollars a piece, whereas the substrates that were typically processed on these cells cost a few thousand dollars a piece. So of course you had to do substantial modifications to the system in order to make it cost efficient also for this industry. So in around 1998, we emitted the first four-tube horizontal furnace. Throughput was roughly 70,000 square centimeters per hour, which is the equivalent of a few thousand wafers per day, which is still a tenfold increase over a standard semiconductor tool. Now, PV, as we all know, started to grow in the late 90s quite rapidly, mainly driven by the German feed-in tariffs that were very generous at the time. On the right-hand side, you can see a chart. On the x-axis is the production capacity worldwide. On the y-axis, the cost of the device per watt. Bear in mind, both of these axes are logarithmic in scale. So in, do we have a laser pointer here? Yeah. In 1990, the cumulative production capacity was somewhere around maybe 200 megawatts per year. 10 years later, it's already had increased almost tenfold to 2 gigawatts per year. Another 10 years later, it had to increase to 50 gigawatts per year, so a 50-fold increase in 10 years. And today, we're close to 1 terawatt per year. So from 2000 to 2020, it's a 1,000-fold increase in the annual production capacity worldwide. At the same time, the cost came down from, say, in 2000, when I entered PV, it was around about $5 per watt. Today, it's at an unhealthy below 20 cents per watt. And of course, what I have to say, of course, other or marketing departments will have you believe different, but all the customers mainly produce exactly the same device. So on the technology side, there is very, very little ways to differentiate. It's purely cost-driven. The entire market is purely cost-driven. So one of the drivers that led to the reduction in the price was, of course, the price of polysilicon. There was a spike because it was in short supply for a while, but then it came down from initially $30 per kilogram down to 8 kilograms, and that's where it's going to stay in the years to come. At the same time, device efficiency increased from 15% to 21%. And of course, production efficiency also increased. We're, or the industry is using a lot less raw materials these days for the same device. But for us as equipment manufacturers, of course, such a price decline is we have to adapt to. We have to emulate also in our systems. So what became the most important metric in designing our tools was CapEx. The tools needed to be very cost effective because it was purely cost driven market. The second metric was the output per system and the footprint. Customers were installing these systems in clean rooms. Clean rooms are very expensive to run, so we had to make these systems compact while maintaining throughput. And also, of course, customers don't want to run too many automation systems, so the output per system needed to be high. As the price came down more and more, customers were not just considering CapEx, but also cost of operation. So we had to make these systems more efficient. Now, if you compare a system that we delivered in the late 1990s, early 2000s, to a system that we deliver today to the industry, you'll see that even nominally, the CapEx for the system hasn't increased. It's kept the same, not even adjusted for inflation. And the output has increased almost 30-fold. While it has, at the same time, become more energy efficient and more efficient in terms of consumables. That's the way we kept up with the steep decline of the cost in the PV industry. We were excited when Amprius contacted us in the first half of 2021, and we jointly tried to see if we could employ these systems that are used in commodity markets also for the unique anode design that Amprius has developed. Of course, these systems are by far what we believe today the most efficient systems to do a CVD process. They are copied everywhere in China. You'll see lots of Chinese systems that look very similar. They have really prevailed over all other CVD systems. So we focused together with Amprius to use this highly efficient machine also for the silicon deposition in their anode. It was difficult. We had to learn, jointly learn, in the first few months, but eventually we succeeded. And we realized we had to slightly modify the system, the PV-based system, to make it suitable for Amprius application. But in the second half of 2022, we were very happy to be able to deliver the very first system here to Amprius with slight modification. Of course, work continues. We're jointly refining the system to make it more efficient, more suitable for the needs of Amprius. But we're also looking at the next steps. At Centrotherm, of course, one of the key markets is PV, and PV is asking for continuous cost reduction. So we've developed a new platform that we call C Plasma Q. We'll release it next year, and the main benefits, once again, will be lower CapEx, increased throughput, lower footprint. That's what the industry is asking for, and, of course, lower total cost of ownership. If you compare it to a standard system that we deliver to the industry today, we'll once again remain at the same CapEx while increasing throughput by somewhere around 60%, and the system will be a lot more efficient in terms of consumption of energy and process gas. So in summary, PECVD systems that we developed for PV had to focus on cost reduction. It had to be very efficient because it's a cost-driven market. We were excited when Amprius contacted us and see if we could employ this system also for their silicon anode application. In the end, we were successful, delivered the platform here. Of course, work continues, but we're excited for Centrotherm for this new opportunity. We release the new PECVD platform next year, and already we are entering into discussion with Amprius to see if we can also use this system for their application. And here's a few images of the collaboration, and thanks to the entire Amprius system, Amprius team, for this exciting opportunity and very, really fruitful discussions that we have. We also learn a lot about our systems from Amprius. Thank you.